another affront to liberty over the weekend. Another assault on the drivers of Pittsburgh, those in which the roads were made for. That's right, more street closures, and not because of PennDOT, although we will get into that in a little bit. But again, the big bike lobby shutting down a major roadway in the city to create chaos everywhere. Look, I don't care if they want to shut down some rinky-dink road. Shut down Strawberry Way, okay? Shut down, what is it, Sedgwick Street right here in Millville. Shut that down. Don't shut down the West End Bridge! For fuck's sake, don't shut down the West End Bridge. What's wrong with you? I mentioned before I was in Lawrenceville for the last open streets, and I almost didn't make it to Hambones. I almost turned around and didn't patronize a business in Lawrenceville because I couldn't find my way there. I couldn't find a parking spot available. Nothing. Because all the roads were blocked off, the main road was down, so you had to zigzag your way around it, and every other freaking side street going to Butler Street was blocked off, so that way the cyclists can take over the road and just create all sorts of havoc. So, again, Strawberry Way, I'm cool with that. Go down the back-ass alley. Please, throw up some tables, throw up some tents, make it a party. Have fun. Go at it. I'm cool with that. Don't take down major roadways, though. You wonder why people who drive cars hate you? That's why. Because you do stuff like that. Again, have fun. Do what you want. Just do not tread on me. That's all I'm asking. Welcome to the River's Edge Radio Network. I am the most interesting man in the burg, Brian Crawford, and I am joined by Jeremy Papay. He is across the table from me. How are you doing?
Good. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for coming. Yeah, we are. We have an interesting show today. We've got more actually with questionable practices. We're going to talk a little bit about UPMC, and they are the nonprofit with all the profit here in Pittsburgh. And there was an interesting editorial that was written, and the editorial was written by Eric Heil, who is a writer for the Post-Gazette, and I always enjoy his stuff. He always has interesting editorials, and this one is about UPMC, and they were recently forced to pay $2.5 million for overbilling their patients, and It's interesting, the article. Let me see. Where can I put down? He says, a complaint included allegations that certain donors did not spend the time required in operating rooms to bill the insurers for the operations. Some even booked themselves as assistants and simultaneously occurring procedures, often racing from suite to suite to process informally referred to as speed surgery. And whenever UPMC was asked for a comment, let's see, it said they issued a statement that said that under the settlement, UPMC has no liability under the settlement that they pushed through. But he wrote an interesting, he kind of took some creative writing approach to his editorial here. And he has, an industry observer who wished not to be identified in case he was ever treated at the UPMC facility termed the depressingly small penalty a win-win for UPMC. The observer noted that the financial settlement likely distracted people from mediocre evaluations several UPMC hospitals received Wednesday in the latest federal government quality ratings. UPMC Mercy received 2 out of 4 possible stars, as did UPMC Presbyterian and UPMC Shadyside, which were combined into one entity in the Centers of Mediocrity, Medicare and Medicaid service ratings. Responding to low marks, UPMC pointed to the difficulties inherent in concurrently providing quality patient care and focusing on its primary mission of medical profiteering. So you can see a little bit of creative writing here. I'm sure that wasn't said, but Spin Mighty wouldn't speculate on how long it might take for UPMC to recover from the wrist slap, but the conglomerate rebounded quickly from a similar injury suffered in 1998 when it paid the government $17 million after auditors uncovered another overbilling scheme. Spin Mighty, I love that name, also declined to discuss the reports that UPMC might rebrand itself in the wake of the settlement to attract more physicians aligned with its core philosophy. Speculation that UPMC changing its corporate colors from lavender to green and its motto from life-changing medicine to profit-enhancing regimen. And that's really the truth. He nails it. You got to read the full editorial. I didn't read the beginning because I wanted to get to some of these awesome quotes that came out of this editorial. But check it out at the Post-Gazette. It's hilarious. Actually, no, I'm sorry. This came from the Tribune Review. Check it out at the Tribune Review. It's great. Very funny, the whole article. And it just really speaks to the truth about UPMC. UPMC is just just bringing in the profits. So much money. I, in my previous occupation, which I'm not going to list here just for their sake, but I was able to actually make my way up into the corporate headquarters of UPMC. And let me tell you, fantastic. Fantastic. I got the wrong screen up here. Fantastic. This is what happens when you don't have a producer. Let's just say they have entire walls that are touchscreen computers. The top floor of the tallest building in Pittsburgh. Huge sign hanging from the building, right? That just is screaming profit, screaming money, flaunting wealth. Nonprofit? I guess that's what they are on the books. Let's see if we can, we got Mike Geica up here in a few minutes, but after Matt, let's see if we can give them a call. Let's see if we can give UPMC a call and see what's going on. Again, I can tell you I've been in corporate headquarters, law firm headquarters, all across Pittsburgh, multiple times, big CEO offices, everything. And outside of maybe PPG, UPMC has among the most lavish in the city. And it's not even close. They are just soaking in money. Don't let them fool you. And it drives me nuts because they're denying care at their hospitals to patients of rival insurance companies. But they don't stop those donations from coming in, baby. Oh no. Keep them coming. Don't worry about that. It just drives me nuts. It's insane to me that they could still be branded as a nonprofit organization. It's mind baffling. It really is. And that's what they're considered. They're considered nonprofit, and the city, I know they tried under Luke Ravenstahl to challenge that. It didn't get anywhere, and now Bill Peduto has stopped with that challenge. And I think it was a worthy challenge. Whenever you're taking in donations, you're tax-free, you're not paying taxes, and you're the largest property owner in the city, and you've got your building on the top floor of the tallest building with the most lavish decor, I don't think it's unreasonable to expect an organization like that to pay its fair share. Up next, we have Matt Geica with your sports report, your weekly sports report here on the River's Edge Radio Network.
Hey, this is Matt Geica, your host of Geic's Got Game, 8 a.m. every Friday here on the River's Edge. I'll take a peek behind the sports media curtain, zoom out for the big picture, and as always, obsess over the details of the sports, teams, and players we love or love to hate. It's Geic's Got Game, every Friday at 8 a.m. on the River's Edge.
All right, welcome back to the River's Edge Radio Network. Just remember, you can give us your money on Patreon if you want to support local music. We are Pittsburgh's 24/7 local music station. And to promote local music, just to let you know, you listened to Watch My World Die, and that is from Boulevard of the Allies. And we're going to talk a little bit about the crisis going on right in Troy Hill, right at the edge of Troy Hill, right after we talk to Matt. But we have Matt Geica on the phone right now. Matt, how are you doing?
Outstanding. Back from Milwaukee. I always love the Midwest, so I'm not going to complain about that.
Awesome. And I know there's a lot going on. The Pirates made a big trade, and it could definitely possibly shape the future of this season, at least.
Oh, no doubt. Yeah, they traded their ninth-inning guy, their closer, their back-end bullpen arm, whatever you want to call him. Mark Melancon is off to Washington to pitch for the Nationals, at least for the end of this season. He was going to be a free agent, and the Pirates wanted to get something for him because they realized he was not going to re-sign, apparently, with the Pirates. They wanted to get something for him, so they picked up a bullpen pitcher of their own from the Nationals that they really like, and Felipe Rivero. He won't be the ninth-inning guy for the Pirates, but you'll see him in the seventh, and if you watch Sunday's game in Milwaukee, first of all, God bless you, because it was a miserable game for the Pirates. But if you watched it, then you saw Rivero make his debut and get a couple of strikeouts and a somewhat steady outing. Also had some control issues for a bit. But really good stuff from him, just looking at the grander scheme. They also, the Pirates, did pick up a prospect pitcher, but he's well down in the minor leagues. So it'll be a little while before you see him. But the Pirates trying to have it both ways in at least one form. They're still in the playoff chase, although after being swept in Milwaukee, they're four games behind the final playoff spot with 2 months to go, but also angling toward the future. And Rivero, the pitcher they picked up from Washington, will be under their control for the next five seasons. So it's kind of like the trade that brought Melancon to town in the first place. They traded the Pirates, did Joel Hanrahan to the Red Sox. They got a young pitcher, unproven, in Mark Melancon, and he turned out great. And if this becomes even 75% of what the Mark Melancon trade did, then the Pirates will have been successful.
Do you think it will turn out to be a good trade, or do you think this will turn out to be a mistake?
Well, I think Rivero has some excellent swing and miss stuff. He's got a fastball that's up in the high 90s and a really good changeup, and even a slider that we saw a little bit yesterday that he turned to in some two-strike situations. It's tough to tell, Brian. Who knows? I know the Pirates loved Rivero, and they wouldn't have made this deal if they didn't. They asked for him by name, in fact, from the Nationals, sensing that Washington wanted to help for its bullpen as it runs toward an apparent division title. So the Pirates, like I said, are trying to be kind of in the middle. They sold off a player, but they also picked up someone who can help them now, and they hope into the future. So it's so difficult to grade this out, and I hate grading trades on the day of. But you can look at value, and what the Pirates got doesn't quite match up with what other teams got for trading high-end relief pitching. Aroldis Chapman went to the Cubs for a huge prospect haul, and Andrew Miller also went to the Indians yesterday, and that was a nice return for the Yankees in that trade. But the Pirates didn't want to go the prospect route necessarily, or at least all the way. They tried to get one of each, and time will tell how this pans out.
I heard your voice this morning, Matt, on the premiere of DK Radio. Your voice is just about everywhere, huh?
My voiceover career has begun. Leave Schreiber needs to watch out. But it was exciting to voice it, to do the intro for Tim Benz's new show on our website on dkpittsburghsports.com. It's DK Sports Radio, as you mentioned. And not only will he have the morning show that's led off with my voice, of course, but he'll also have on-demand interviews throughout the day. So I'm excited to see how this works out. And to get Tim Benz was a nice pickup, a great pickup. Speaking of deadline deals and signings and all that, that's one for our site, no doubt.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Tim Benz. He's actually been a big influence on myself and in my radio career, so it was very cool to listen to him on your guys' website. Anything else going on in the world of sports?
Well, the PGA Championship wrapped up over the weekend in New Jersey. Jimmy Walker edged out Jason Day for his first career major. So in golf, we had four major championships, including the one right here in Pittsburgh in our backyard, the U.S. Open, won by first-time major champion. So that's a pretty rare thing. It was Dustin Johnson winning at Oakmont, and that was a tremendous victory for him, overcoming a whole bunch of things to get that done. So I guess it depends on what you're looking for as an individual sports fan. Do you want to see the players who win a lot continue to do so, or do you want to see some breakthroughs? I'm kind of in between there, but Good story, a good player in Jimmy Walker. And that leads right into the Olympics. So that's the reason the PGA Championship wasn't in August this year, as it always is, because golf returns to the Olympics down in Rio de Janeiro. But, of course, there's so many sports and so many events going on. My boss, Dejan Kovacevic, will be in Rio to cover the Pittsburgh angle. Plenty of area athletes, whether it be people who grew up in Pittsburgh or surroundings, or attended local colleges, Pitt, Penn State, West Virginia, some wrestlers from Clarion even are in the Olympics. That's something to look forward to. I love the Olympic Games, whether it be winter or summer, and they're about to get going. It could be a really problematic site, though, with Rio de Janeiro appearing to be a mess. Police not getting paid, hospitals understaffed, buildings not finished. So there tends to be some negative hype when things aren't ready to go for Olympic Games, and that's something that'll play out over the coming weeks, too.
All right. Sounds good. Thank you so much, Matt.
Yeah, Brian. My pleasure.
Check out Matt's show. You too. Check out Matt every Friday here at 8 a.m. We just moved the show to 8 a.m. I actually got like a little bit of sleep today, but I'm still fighting it. Last week was, well, you knew about my story, my hobo story, so I'm still recovering from that. That was dreadful. Up next, we're going to give UPMC a call and see if we can get something straightened out here on the River's Edge.
Hi, I'm Tom, and I know money.
And I'm Matt, and I know funny.
Catch us Thursday mornings at 7 a.m. Real financial information
for the regular guy.
Right here at riversedgepgh.com.
Your voice for local music.
All right, we are back. And you just heard Talking in My Sleep by Devin Moses and The Saved. This UPMC thing is troubling me, and I really want to try to get to the bottom of it. Apparently, they got a really, really light settlement on an issue that is pretty serious, and I'm tired of UPMC always getting away with it. Always, you know, they're non-profit, don't have to pay taxes, they just can seem to do whatever they want. So let's try and give them a call and see if we can get a hold of them. See if we can get a hold of them. There we go, it's ringing. All right, let's see. Trying to get a hold of UPMC. See what's going on with this settlement. We want to see. Not getting anything. You think no one works there? Oh, that's right. Nobody does work there. That's how they got away from, that's right. The judge ruled that nobody works at UPMC. I forgot about that. That's why we're not getting anybody. Nothing at all. That's disappointing. I was hoping to get to the bottom of this. Oh, wait. We have something. Hello? Hello? Can you hear me? Hello? Hello? We're trying to call UPMC. Hello, this is Brian with the River's Edge Radio Network, Brian Crawford. We have a question for you about this settlement. Hello? God, it sounds like there's like an entire legion of people there, and it's nobody's answering the phone. All right, nobody's answering the phone. Forget this. No luck with UPMC. PennDOT is raising the price of rent for a parking lot right across the street from Penn Brewery. I don't know if you saw this in the paper today, but it's another situation of PennDOT just wasting our money. So basically, Penn Brewery has paid PennDOT for years, since the 1990s. I believe it was 1990s, $135 to rent this parking lot. Well, PennDOT decided to reconstruct the parking lot, spend all of this money to repair it, fix it up, and then after the construction is complete, they've decided to raise the price of the rent from $135 to $1,350. Pretty steep price, but again, after construction. So Penn Brewery, who has other parking locations around them, said, thanks, but No thanks. So what did PennDOT do? They put up barricades to block people off so they can no longer park in the brand new parking lot. Brilliant! But of course, they left space available for the cyclists because, heaven forbid, they feel the pain with the rest of us. I'm so sick of PennDOT. I'm so sick of 28. 28, it's supposed to be done. It's supposed to be finished. I couldn't get to work forever because they had the exit coming off 28 into Deutschtown blocked off. And now I can't get home from work because they have the exit going on to 28 blocked off. Just finished 28. They had this big grand celebration where Tom Corbett's down there cutting the ribbon. Woo! We finished 28. No, you did it because they're still blocking off all the exits. I still can't get home. Just please finish 28. That's all I'm asking. And take down the barricades. This is just stupid. I mean, it was a nice parking lot, and people use it. And that's one of the things mentioned in the article, that people do use this parking lot for all sorts of things. They use it to get downtown. They use it to go use the trail. There's a new bike trail that they put along 28, which, again, it's an approved bike trail. I approve of that bike trail because that bike trail is actually aiding vehicle, it's not impeding vehicle traffic, I should say. And like I said, there do need to be bike lanes in certain areas in town, but where they end up putting them, not always the best location. What do we have next? Oh, next, that's right, in 25 seconds, your weird news here on the River's Edge.
Hi, I'm Mike Storr, host of The Awesome Cast, which you can hear right here on River's Edge Radio. We're talking tech, getting geeky every week with people from Pittsburgh in the industry. Go check us out, awesomecast.net, or listen to us right here on River's Edge Radio, Thursday mornings, 8 a.m. after Funny Money.
All right, security guard. Well, we got a security guard here. Let's cue the music. All right, this security guard, his friend is a pain in the ass, literally a pain in the ass. And this happened just up the road from the Millville Studios at Ross Park Mall on a Tuesday night. Security guard was on duty, and around 11 p.m., his friend shot him in the ass. Like I said, his friend is literally a pain in the ass. If anyone's advocating gun control, it's probably this guy. How do you shoot someone in the ass? That's my question. Good aim, I guess. But yeah, the guy shot the guy in the ass, and now he was working a shift. So the security guard, security officer was actually ending his shift, according to Ross Township Police. It was 11 o'clock at night. He was preparing to go home when he was loading his personal firearm, and it got discharged. So, crazy. So, oh, yeah. So stay clear of Ross Park Mall, I guess, for renegade bullets, and you don't want to get shot in the ass. What do we have next? Oh, that's right. Next, we have Jeremy. He's going to be up next. Jeremy Papay. He is coming up in just a minute here. But that is your weird news. Pain in the ass. Don't be a pain in the ass. That's all I'm saying. Jeremy's up next, and we're going to talk a little bit about his career, which is very, very fascinating. His music career, I think, is one of the more interesting ones that we'll have discussed here on the River's Edge. But he's up next on the River's Edge Radio Network.
Would you be interested in developing conscious choice? Would you be interested in creating reactions rather than waiting for one to come? Would you be interested in combining serendipity and synchronicity? Would you be interested in making 1 + 1 = 3? Would you be interested in finding out about full impact mindfulness? If so, I challenge you to join myself, Jim Ellermeyer, a cognitive behavioral health therapist, every Sunday morning at 7 a.m. on the River's Edge, where we will challenge you to allow us to help you help yourself to fully participate in your life. Let the adventure begin.
All right, welcome back to the River's Edge Radio Network. You just heard Strange Future by Wolves in Sheep's Clothing. And we have some new things coming to the River's Edge. I don't want to give it away just yet, but we have some really exciting things coming. Some new shows, new programs, some shows and programs that are just completely different than anything we have currently available for you. So stay tuned for that. That's going to be very, very exciting. But right now, we have an exciting guest. We have Jeremy Papay right across the table from me. How are you?
Good, good. I've been called so much worse than exciting, so I guess am I good here?
There we go. You're good now. Right, yeah, awesome. I had the other mic queued up, but that makes... No, we're good.
You got my nipple nice and clear, right?
Yes, yeah, so we got that sound coming through really well. Right. So, yeah, so I'm excited to have you on. I've met you at going to different open mic nights and things like that.
I think... It was like the Hambones broadcast, I think.
Okay, yes, the initial,
You guys did like the brunch, I think.
Yes, yes. Yeah. We'll be back at the brunch for Rant, actually. Okay. So, so you'll be able to catch us there as well.
Yeah, that sounds like an awesome festival. I'm actually going to be gigging out of town that entire weekend.
I'm kind of
bummed about that. But yeah, the lineup always looks great.
Yeah, this is my first time being involved, and I'm very excited because Rant is... really the festival that started it all of these major festivals all came after Rant, and Rant kind of trailblazed the way things like Deutschtown and Strip District and everything else
lot of those, like, I missed all that. I was away for so long. I kind of came back and
why were you away?
An interesting career move back in 2008 was when it was. I got the call and left to go play drums for the Wriggling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus.
Can you pull your mic just a little bit towards you?
I will.
So that's really cool. Right. that must have been fun. Where did you travel? Did you travel across the country? Or
I've crossed off everything but Alaska and Hawaii at this point.
Wow.
We didn't necessarily play in every state, but... you know,
but you were there, yeah.
I traveled and at least, you know, stopped at a Flying J or something, so that counts.
Yes, exactly.
In the RV.
How did you play? Was it like a band that just was like associated with the
full live band? Traveled with, you know, you have the show, you have the performers, you know, you have all the crew, and then you have we were the Ringling Brothers band where we were out on the floor. You know, we had our own silly costumes we had to wear, and you know, everybody traveled together. Everybody had their own RV, and we would just play the shows, go to the next city, reconvene, set up in the parking lot there again, and the arena was right next to it. And we would do usually sound check opening night Thursday, sometimes a kiddie show Friday night, three shows Saturday most times, and then one or two shows on Sunday. Load out, tear down, pack up the RV, and drive anywhere between, you know, 90 to 900 miles to the next
town.
How
did you get involved in something like that?
A fellow Pittsburgh musician by the name of Steve Palko had been out. He was a bass player. He'd been out on the road for a couple years. I was at Duquesne with him in the music school. The drummer before me put in his notice, didn't want to do it anymore. Steve dropped my name. I got a phone call. I thought it was a joke the first time I got the call. I'm not sure. I have to ask Robbie. I don't know if I actually hung up on him or just could not believe that was actually true after he called. But yeah, I had, you know, from there, said yes, that I'd, you know, buy an RV. I'd go play this insane gig. And then I had maybe a week and a half, 2 weeks. They flew me to Mississippi to like watch the show and get acclimated to the lot and kind of get a sense for it. And I came back with a video of the show, and from there had a week and a half to 2 weeks to figure out, you know, what an RV was at that point. Get one, get a truck, learn the show from like a, you know, a video. And then I left Pittsburgh and drove to Prescott Valley, Arizona for my first time taking the RV across the country. My dad came with me on that trip, so that was kind of cool. But yeah, and that lasted about 7.5 years. I got back in town October of last year, late October.
Was that a hard decision?
It was mine. They actually closed our tour down. They decided...
Was it a hard decision to join the circus?
No, not really. Like, at the point, I was... my old band, I played in this band, Chalk Outline Party. We had kind of disbanded a year before. I was kind of... you don't want to call it a slump. I was like treading water in Pittsburgh. You know, I'd played in so many bands. I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. I was getting the itch to travel. This thing kind of fell in my lap. And it was, you know, the best way to completely shake up my life and not really think about it and just dive into the deep end head first. And yeah, I don't regret that at all. And that was not our decision to make. I mean, I freaked out. Like, don't get me wrong.
Sure.
I think I remember actually the singer in that band. We went to see, I think, Tom Petty at Star Lake. And I remember that I think I was just shaking the whole time. Like, what have I done? Like, oh,
yeah.
Like, yeah, because there was no, you know, no turning back after that. But
did you have a smartphone?
Not until I was late to the game. 2012 is when I got my first.
I feel like that would be a much easier job to take on if you had a smartphone and you had all of that back home where you're able to see what people were doing and interact
with
people.
Well, I still had the, you know, the laptop and everything like that.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
And I think with the Facebook thing and everything, I mean, a lot of people are down on it. Like, that's really how I not only stayed connected to people back home, but also all over the country, like the friends that I've met everywhere. It's just a great way to keep up.
Well, it's wonderful. And people knock Facebook, and it definitely has its faults. I mean, look at the comments. Yeah. But I reconnected with a cousin that I may never have seen again in my life if it wasn't for Facebook. So you're right. It's great for things like that.
The algorithms are strange, though, because like I actually don't see as many circus friends on my feed. You know, it's more Pittsburgh based now, which is fine because, you know, I have a lot of people that I enjoy keeping up with here as well. But yeah, I tend to check in on folks all around the country and kind of see how everybody's doing, what everybody's up to, see if I want to go there or not.
Yeah, I was on a cruise recently and they had musicians that were on the cruise and it was crazy to me because you would think of any benefit that you would offer your people on the cruise, that internet would be one of them.
Yeah,
But they did not.
No.
So these people had to pay for the internet if they wanted it. And
not the quickest out there at times.
Well, not only that, but on the cruise, you're looking at buku bucks. Mm-hmm. I mean, they charge at a premium because you're out at sea. There's no Wi-Fi available. You can't, you know, duck into a McDonald's and, you know, steal the Wi-Fi for a few minutes. You're stuck in that building. And I remember the prices were astronomical for internet.
We'd have performer friends, and they would put the disclaimer up, you know, hey, you know, I'll check in with everybody in like 3 days when I'm at port and can get Wi-Fi again. But I considered jumping on one. It was always an option. I wanted to see if I could make it happen for myself in Pittsburgh, just out of defiance of the gig closing, and like I'll come back and still do drumming as a full-time career. Getting there still.
It takes a while,
But the cruise ship's always an option.
Now, you played with elephants before. That's cool.
There are a few. I mean, there's tons of career highlights, but yeah, I think
picture of you playing drums with an elephant.
We were in Biloxi, Mississippi, where the arena is like right across from the Gulf of Mexico. There's this huge, like basically they hang out on the beach more or less. And I asked, you know, Alex the trainer, I'm like, hey, I have this idea. Cause he had approached me before. April though, the 4-year-old is also a drummer. You know, they had at some point there was a bucket and she just went over and picked up a branch and started playing on the bucket. So early in the tour, I'd given him some old drumsticks to pass on to April so she could play drums. And then we set up the kit and just started playing, and they love, you know, like any kid, she just loves to make noise and bang on stuff. So we had the cymbal set up and she would pick it up and, you know,
broke it.
No. She definitely could have broken all of the drums or the drumsticks, or me if she wanted to. But she was having a blast. I think I still have elephant snot on my ride cymbal and my floor tom. But yeah, they're just curious. Asia, the other elephant, you know, we had a tambourine on the ground and she just picked that up and would like shake that and did a little mic drop on it. On my YouTube channel, all those videos are.
Oh, really?
Are up
where
there.
Can we find that?
I believe it's just if you just search for my name, Jeremy Papay, YouTube, the drum videos will probably come up first, but there's all the playlists in there, and in those drum videos are some of the ones. I think I have like my Cirque du Soleil audition up there, and then some of the elephant jam sessions.
That's awesome.
I miss them so much.
What are some of the other interesting experiences you had in the circus? Because I feel like that job, you would see so much. There's just so much that would that you would be exposed to, and you would experience that. You know, I talk about my previous job and all of the different sites and things I was able to see that, and many people have seen portions of those sites, but no one has seen all of them. And I feel like in the circus, you have experiences that very few can say they've experienced, especially in today's circus, where it is a nationwide big event. It's not, you know, I remember there's images of the circus that would show up to Irwin, Pennsylvania. Well, the circus isn't going to Irwin anymore.
There's still like tons of family circuses, mud shows, they call them, under the tent that'll still, but they were kind of, you know, there was Ringling and their Cirque and you know, and the other ones that would be like the arena shows. But,
yes.
But yeah, we would, we played some small towns for sure. I remember a few in Kentucky in particular, and a few small towns in Texas, but we would do, you know, like Portland, we would play, and we'd play like the Rose Garden Arena or the Moda Center or whatever it's called now. But, you know, I completely fell in love with the Pacific Northwest, Montana. Mm-hmm. We had a week off. They stuck us in Billings for a week off. So I shot north to Great Falls, where there's this amazing tiki bar called the Sip and Dip, where they have like mermaid shows. And there's this woman, Piano Pat, who's played there every Wednesday through Saturday for something like 40 years something. And then went up to Glacier National Park. You know, when we were in South Dakota, we, you know, did the Badlands. It's, you're in a town for a week basically, and you have a couple, you know, a few days off. So any chance I would get to go climb on something or be somewhere in nature, I would jump on that for sure. Like the Sandias in New Mexico. You know, I miss New Orleans a lot. we would play around it, but we would be close enough that I could get down there several times a year and see my crazy sideshow and circus and burlesque and musician friends down there.
Now you're back in Pittsburgh. You say you're trying to become a full-time musician in the Pittsburgh area. Yeah. How difficult is that here in Pittsburgh?
Oh, I mean, I found when you're away for a while and then come back, I found it a little strange. Like, I tend to hit the ground like running.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, just from the pace of being on the road, like, I don't do well with downtime at all. So I'm not sure if I was, like, overly aggressive, but came back and like, hey, I'm a drummer. I want to play with you. Like, let's
all over.
Do,
yeah, you
got to
get the word
the
out, right?
But,
yeah.
You know, I mean, I kind of prepped a little bit where I knew I was coming back. I joined up with this real, like, super pro band, the Michael Christopher Band, where the calendar is just, you know, a mile long. We play all over the place, like constantly every weekend.
Mm-hmm.
So like that's going well. Like I've done a lot of theater work. So actually at the Playhouse in Oakland, I came back and did a show there right off the bat. I think I'm doing Tommy there in October. But you know, I mean, you know, doing day gigs here and there, but trying to make it happen after you play drums for a living for 7.5 years. It's hard to, you know, even if I'm just being stubborn at the moment, to try to keep that going.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of great stuff going on, man. There's so much talent in the city.
I think one thing, and I know I've talked to other people about this, one way to try to get into music professionally as your career, you almost have to be like a journalist where you have your feet in your, you know, your toes in different waters, your hand, you know, hands in different, you know,
that's the
occupations.
The biggest thing, like, I took away from Duquesne anyway was just, I think my sophomore year, my junior year, like, you only get credit for playing in X number of ensembles, but I think I did either 10 or 11, just when the opportunity to play in a symphony, then a, you know, contemporary ensemble, and then there's the jazz, and then there's, you know, all the other electronic stuff. And so when I've given talks at like high schools, I'm talking to kids like, how do I do it? I'm like, you play with everybody. You're a metal drummer, great. Like,
sure.
go play jazz. Like, right, you're a jazz drummer, you know, here's some punk to go listen to and play. Like, I think, you know, playing in symphonies and learning how an orchestra breathes has, like, helped my rock playing, you know, getting in early. The gig on the road was all V-drums, Rollin, like, virtual drums.
Mm-hmm.
And I got in early on that, and I think that helped get me the gig with the circus, too.
Well, that's one area where I feel like jazz musicians kind of get it. Mm-hmm. You always see, at least my observation, just following different musicians, you know, on Facebook and social media and things like that. I'm friends with a lot of people. Mm-hmm. It seems like the jazz musicians are the ones who are willing to just like sell themselves to play for anybody. Hey, you need a, you know, a upright bass today? I'm your guy. I play upright bass, and they don't care if it's jazz. They're playing all over. Where it seems like a lot of musicians in other genres seem to stick to their craft.
Yeah, you'll get not flack, but I mean, there's when you're called up like a working musician or whatever. Like I love, you know, I play, you know, with I still play in rock bands. I play with Amoeba Knievel. It's like one of the really, really fun bands I play with. But I'll also, if I get a call, you know, to go do a theater gig or wherever, or you just make yourself available. That's part of, you know, making it. Like I don't really feel there's any shame in doing that when you you know you can get by and you can read and do that, then why wouldn't you take any gig? At least as a drummer, like I would get that. Like, how do you play the same show like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times? Where like with circus drumming, I have a little more freedom to kind of not do whatever I want, but as a drummer, I feel, you know, I was a little more open to not do everything the same way every time.
Yeah, no, and that's good that they would allot you that kind of freedom, because I always feel that breeds creativity.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? If you have that freedom, and that's one of the things I always try to encourage is, you know, like, you know, the hosts on this program, you know, I don't, you know, a lot of, and that is true in a lot of radio companies where, you know, the management comes down, oh, you have to do it this way, and, you know, you have to say this and say that. Now, you know, we do have, like, station promos and stuff like that that have to be read, but your content is your content as long as you're not out there, like, saying, you know, we get a sponsor, oh, you know, this is the worst, you know, pizza in the world, or, you know, beyond that, it's your show. You have creative freedom to kind of do what you need, and I feel like we have a better brand for that. So, and you know, if you're an artist, that's how you're going to, I think you're going to present better art if you're allowed the freedom to.
Yeah, well, I mean, even with this, with the Michael Christopher band, like, coming into it, like, the some of the covers and stuff, that's not really my favorite genre, but within the parts themselves, like, I'm playing really fun parts, and I'm playing with really fun people, so it you know, I guess maybe listening to it versus playing it are like two different experiences. And I've always felt way more comfortable in society on a stage than off of it.
Yeah,
but and it's been an adjustment too, coming from like circus drumming is so different from, because you're, you know, catching anytime an acrobat flips or whatever, you're keeping time, but you're also playing drum fills in time, sometimes out of time, you know, it was triggering like 120 pre-sampled loops per show, and to go from all that to like just playing, not just playing drums in some of these gigs, but it's definitely been an interesting transition, and I've probably overplayed way more than I should have on a lot of gigs.
Well, you're actually going to play for us right now, correct?
Oh, yeah. Can I get a few plugs in? Do we have time?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Actually, there.
I own the network, so I can do whatever I want.
Nice.
The only demands I have is Facebook on our Facebook Live. They will cut me off at an hour and a half, so we still have some time.
Okay, right on. Well, on the 26th, my buddy Clint Van Gammert, who I actually went to high school with, I played in a band in high school with, we have a duo, upright bass and drums. We'll play the 26th of August, I believe that's at the Funhouse with the great Joanna Lowe and the Working Breed, I think, is the other band that's on that show. I don't think it's been an event yet. I'm actually going to play, speaking of Joanna and Cup of Joe Productions, there's Titus Andronicus, this amazing production of that at 634. That's going to run September 30th through October 7th. Those tickets are at Eventbrite. There's a big show with the Michael Christopher band coming up. We don't play locally all that often because we're all over the place, but we'll be at the Oaks Theater September 30th, and that'll be like as close as we get for a while. So yeah, I think that's it. Sorry to get that. That's all.
No, I know. I'm glad you got that through there, and it gave me a second to check a Facebook comment that I've been trying to read. So one of your friends is listening and said rock on.
Oh,
so
nice.
Yeah, so that was cool.
Awesome.
Are you going to be, for my own knowledge, are you going to be at the event tonight at Smalls? Or will you not be there? I know you have a meeting to go to.
Oh, yeah. I'm not sure that there's... I'm hoping to, actually, because I think... I can't remember who's hosting tonight. But yeah, but the Monday night... Cafe, I mean, that's like Monday nights at the Funhouse and Tuesdays at Hambones, like that. I was real. I should have mentioned that when I came back home. Like, that was the crew that I immediately kind of fell in with. And
me too,
was,
as well, actually. And
everybody was very, very warm and welcoming, and I'm really glad I met a lot of people.
I cannot say enough good things about that group, because you see a lot of the same people at both events, and they've definitely helped build our library, and you can see the different artists up above.
Yeah, I was checking out your ceiling.
That's not all of the artists, but that is a good portion of them. So.
Right on.
But we do have a song, so I'm excited to hear this.
Yeah. I kind of just started writing on the road. Like, I never really played guitar, but these are all recent songs, and I guess this one seems to get reactions because it's angry, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, the story is long gone, so it's just a song now, but it's about a couple people, actually Circus and Pittsburgh back and forth. But anyway, this is called You Stay Classy.
After this, we got your holiday of the day up next, so stay tuned.
Rock on.
Yeah, you stay classy with your ponytail and hair. Yeah, you stay classy with that unstable stare. The blood's a boiling, that temper's gonna flare, boy. But you stay classy and pretend that I care. Yeah, you stay classy and you call her a whore. She's made a mistake again, she's made it before. In time she'll figure you out and I'll show you the door. But you stay classy and we'll settle the score. You've been held up in your head for too long. Seeing things that ain't there, you got it all wrong. A friend will help a friend to meet a friend and then two knobs in my back, that really was the end. Yeah, you stay classy, you see two sides of your face. To say one's trusted you is such a disgrace. You never deserve my friendship, time to make haste. But you stay classy and get put in your place. You've been held up in your head for too long. Seeing things that ain't there, you got it all wrong. A friend will help a friend to meet a friend and then two knobs in my back, that really was the end. But you stay classy. Yeah, you stay classy. Yeah, you stay classy, fucker.
Woo!
Cool. Thanks so much.
Very cool. So it is time. You're welcome to celebrate with me. It's time to celebrate.
Do I get a clacker too?
Yeah, here, you can have a clacker. We're looking to celebrate, and people are looking for a good time, right? So we're about to give it to them. Here, we've got your holiday of the day. We're going to give you a holiday every day that you can celebrate. These are legitimate holidays. They
are
on the calendar somewhere. There's a big website of them. So we're going to give you the holiday of the day. We've got two of them for you today. So let's cue the music. In honor of UPMC and the way that they profiteer, I'm surprised they haven't taken advantage of this this holiday, but it is Minority Doctors Day. So there you go. If you have a minority doctor, you could celebrate. You can, wonk on a horn, give him a piece of candy, buy him get him a water or something. Do something. Do something nice for a minority doctor. That's all we're saying. Celebrate minority doctors. It's good to be diversified. And then also today is Mutt's Day. And I don't know, have you ever had a dog?
I've had a
mutt or a purebred?
We've had both. There are actually a lot of mutts on the show, rescue mutts.
Okay, yeah, I'm a big fan of mutts. I've had two of them myself. Mm-hmm. And I actually had a dog that was really special to me. And we got this dog when I was two. So we actually had the dog before my sister. Mm-hmm. And the dog, it's one of the only memories I have of the time we lived in Florida. I was forced to sleep in a hallway. We lived in a trailer. We moved to this trailer, and everybody, my grandmother owned the trailer. Mm-hmm. And for some reason, she decided to move into the trailer with us, and so did my aunts and everybody else. And we had a million people living in this trailer, and I was forced out of my bedroom into a hallway. And I just remember the dog walking by. But the dog was so smart. It could open up doors, open up windows. Mm-hmm. It knew everything. It knew perfect English. And I remember when we moved to our new home, we moved to a smaller yard, and she started walking down the street, and I said, Silky, this is the yard, and she never left again.
Huh.
Very intelligent. So, yeah.
Smart creature.
Yes, dogs are smart. I don't know. I miss my dog. She was a good dog. But what do we have coming up? Oh, that's right. Tomorrow, don't forget, tomorrow we have Mike Sasson. He is back in studio for week 3. Good stuff with Mike, and I am back on Wednesday, Amanda Narcisse of boldpittsburgh.com. She will be with us. Amanda's awesome. She tells you everything that you should do every weekend. Fun things, places to drink, places to eat. And we're also going to have Johnny St. Lethal of the show. He's going to be on before his last performance ever with the show. Maybe not his last performance, but the show's last performance at Mr. Smalls. And we're going to have Mark Dingham in as well. Don't forget, nice. You can sponsor us.
That's one of my favorites.
Yeah, he's a good guy. You can sponsor us on Patreon. You can click the link at the bottom of the website. How can people reach you, Jeremy?
Through the Facebook music page, Jeremy Papay Music, PAPAY, at Twitter, same deal, JPAPAY on Instagram, anywhere there's social media, I can be found, and I definitely will come play your gig.
Yes, hit him up. He is a professional musician. He's a professional, that's what happens when you're tired all the time. Sorry. Mike Sasson tomorrow at 10 a.m. live at riversedgepgh.com. I'm out.